Hello, AP Environmental Science. This unit is about land, public and private, the land use concepts and how we classify them, and land management practices. In land use concepts and classifications, humans value land for what it can provide, like food, shelter, and resources, maybe just its overall intrinsic beauty. However, human use of the land for these purposes can create problems, some of which can be prevented, and we need to address those regulations. In land management practices, whether resources are conserved or overexploited just depends on the number of factors that are related to, like, economics, human behavior, and specific management practices. So proper resource management also depends on specific aspects of the type of land that's involved, as well as the agencies and guidelines. Land management practices. You know, we've seen that resources can be managed or they can be overexploited depending upon the number of factors related, like economics, human behavior, and specific management practices. So proper resource management is dependent upon the specific aspect and the type of land that's involved, and of course the agencies and guidelines that operate it. So after land management practices, be able to explain specific land management practices for rangelands and forests, and then describe contemporary problems in residential land use and some potential solutions. Because you know, in AP Environmental, we're all about the solutions. So now that we have some sort of basic picture about how public land is classified and the relationship between public land use and management agencies that are especially in the United States, let's turn to something more specific issues that involve different types of public lands. Note that many management issues that we discuss apply to private lands as well. So a rangeland is an open, dry area of grassland. This open, dry grassland is primarily used for grazing cattle, and which is most common in the western part of the United States. Rangelands are ecosystems that are particularly susceptible to forest fires and really any other sort of environmental disturbance. So when humans overuse or overgraze these rangelands, it's easy to lose the biodiversity that's there. Like most human activities, livestock grazing has mixed environmental effects. One environmental benefit of grazing is that these ungulates, or what we call these hooved animals like cattle and sheep, they can be raised in lands that are too dry to farm. And so grazing these animals, allows them to eat in areas that are really unhospitable to other things. In addition, grazing these animals uses a lot less fossil fuels and energy to raise them than if they were to be in like a feeding lot or a feeding house. However, improper management of livestock can damage stream banks and pollute surface waters. Grazing too many animals too quickly can reduce the vegetation in that area, which leaves the land very exposed to wind erosion and can make the land and the soil difficult for them to absorb and retain water when it rains. So many environmental scientists argue that rangeland ecosystems are often too fragile for multiple purposes or for multiple use. Certain environmental organizations have suggested that 55% of the U.S. rangeland soils are in very, very poor condition, and that's due to a large part of this overgrazing. However, the government organization, the BLM, which manages most of these public rangelands in the United States, has maintained that the percentage of poor to very poor soils is not nearly really that high. Reconciling that the difference and the challenge because many factors influence how soil conditions are determined, not just grazing cattle. So, the Taylor Grazing Act of 1934 was passed to halt overgrazing. It converted federal rangelands from a commons into a permitted-based grazing system. The goal of this permit-based system is to limit the number of animals grazing in a particular area, and thereby avoiding this tragedy of a common situation. However, critics maintain that this low cost of grazing permits continues to have to encourage overgrazing, because in 2009, the latest year for which we have data that is available, the federal government spent several times more money managing its rangelands than it did receive from the actual permits. And so the effects of grazing is subsidized essentially by federal funds, which in a gist means that we're actually paying to have these cattle graze the land. It's costing the government too much money to monitor this land based on what they're getting out of it. And of course that makes sense. You can't charge farmers or cattle ranchers a huge substantial amount of money to pay for the police or the wildlife management people who monitor this site. So the BLM focuses on basically trying to halt the damage caused by these overgrazing rangelands. And they really need to focus on the overall rangeland health. So when it comes to this grazing guidelines, regulations need to be in place. So for example, state and regional rangeland managers, they're required to essentially ensure the health of their watershed. So they maintain these ecological processes from which nutrient cycles and energy flow and preserved water quality and maintain and restore habitats and protect endangered species. So essentially what that means is the federal government put the states and the people who monitor these sites in charge. They're like, you're responsible for making sure that the cattle rangeland grazing doesn't affect the water quality. So because these managers are not given really any detailed guidance, and they're not also given the authority, which is something your book doesn't mention, the BLM regulations do not require the involvement of environmental scientists. So the managers have a wide latitude set of guidelines and standards, and the regulations are not considered successful at this time because the preserving these vulnerable rangeland ecosystems has been unsuccessful, to say at the least, at that level.